So for the following one, in the coordination of compounds, as we have said, there will be a donor and an acceptor. So the same connection will be one which is called the acceptor, and the donors will be those ones who have the lone pair electrons. You will see that in the coordination compounds, you have it's like the acid-base adducts, frequently called complexes. So here we can have some of them which are the charged and others who are not charged. When you see at the left side also, you see a complex which is not charged. But when you see at the right, you have a complex ion. Complex ion, which means it is a complex molecule which is charged. So of course, as you know, the charged molecules are those ones who are not neutral. To be neutral, it requires an of other molecules. So when you go on, we will see the complex metal. When you have what you call the complex sphere, which is a complex ion, and you wanna make it neutral, there should be other ions which can come to balance this charge. Those are called the counter ions. So the counter ions are those. Ions which does not belong to the complex sphere to make the net charge, which to form the net charge equal to zero. So an example here is this. For this complex ion which you have here, by removing these two prolines, as which you are seeing on the right side, you have a molecule with it, the charge of complex. So, but to have a neutral molecule, there is two new proline atoms which comes to balance this total. This is what we call those two new proline atoms will be called, or new proline ions, sorry, will be called counter ions, just to balance the charge of the compound and to make the whole net charge equal to zero. Yes, you have a question?
Excuse me.
Yes, I'm hearing.
May you increase the voice, please?
The voice? Okay, I'll try my best.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
Let's go on. So, from there, I will not go back, but I think you have heard the important thing. So, for the following, we are going to see what we call the oxidation state and coordination. So, in the coordination compounds, which have been proposed by Alfred, we have two different types of valences. So one is called the secondary valence and another one is called the primary valence. So I think you are hearing it. Okay, can you please mute your microphone? And if you have a volumes of your computer as well, smartphone. So the two types of valence, one is called the primary valence, another one is called the secondary valence. The primary valence will differ to the atom. As you know, in usual, when you say, for example, sodium, we know that its valence is its ability to form ions. It can form a single ion of Na plus. So which means it can access, it can lose just one electron. So when you go to the secondary valence, it will be this ability of the central metal to accept different ligands. Here it is quite different from its ability to form ions. So the secondary ability will differ to this ability of bounding to different or forming the coordination bonds with different ligands. So while the primary valence will differ to the ability of the central metal to form ionic bonds with the opposite charged ions. I mean, for example, if we need to say the cobalt chloride, with the A form, which means can only accept two chloride. So by progressing, this proposition of Alfred has helped a lot in this coordination compounds, because it elucidates normally the difference between the coordinate, the primary balance and the secondary balance, or balance between the coordination compounds and the normal molecules. So the oxidation states, when you go to do the transition metals, which you have already covered, which you have already seen in the syllabus, the transition metals can form a variety of ions by using one or more electrons. This is quite very important, because you find that a single metal can form different complexes, and a single metal can form different molecules within the same atoms, as I have said, because it can contain more than one oxidation state, depending to the molecule in which it is. When you see, for example, the atoms you have here, those the transition metals, you find some of them, like manganese, which possess more than four different oxidation states, which means those are different primary bonds, and so on. Here there is a table, and I think you were seeing it. So know that for the first five metals, the maximum possible oxidation state correspond to the loss of 4s and 3d electrons. And when you see, for example, for chromium, you find that it will have this structure, and it can have, for example, the oxidation state of chromium is 6. What's the light end of the period? The maximum oxidation state are not observed. In fact, two ions are the most common. The high oxidation states are not seen for those metals, because the 3D orbitals become lower in energy. So when you go back, you will find that you have 4s. Let's see, for example, when you go to zinc, I think you are seeing on this table which I am presenting, you see that D10 is already saturated, so we can't move more than 2 electrons which are in S. So the same for copper, you can have only 2. You have the only 1 electron which is there, and you can only have also copper 2 plus or copper 1 plus, so, and so on. But as we are going at the left, we find that the oxidation states are increasing, which shows those metals due to the electrons which are present in a atomic orbital. So from there, let's see about those coordination number. The number of bonds formed by metal ions to the ligands in a complex ion varies from 2 to 8, depending on the size, charge, and the electrons. Here I would like to inform you that once the atom is becoming smaller, it has the high ability to form or to be bound to many complexes. So we'll see it in the details, and from what you have seen in the previous table, you have seen that 6 is the most common coordination number, followed closely by 4. So, and so on. So in many complexes, we only find, we don't find the complex with the one ligand many times. It can exist, but not many times. Not one, I mean 2. But you can find many times 6 and 4 ligands around the same coordinate. Then I lose shows show more than one coordination number, and there is really no simple way to predict what the coordination number will be in a particular case. So, as you understand, except from the experimental reactions, so you find that experimentally, you can know that this is, those are 4 ligands by doing the characterization of the molecule exercise. But no, there is not any other technique to be used to know that this will form 4 or 6, it will be bound to 6 or 5. But from experiments, run experiments, you make the ligand to react with the same formator, and we characterize it, and we find the number of elements which are in the central atom. So, from what you have now, here we have the diagram of the figure which I would like to show you here, where we have the arrangements in complex. So, from the different transition metals we have, for example, from copper, gold, and silver, we find that we have different coordination, different possible coordination numbers. When you go to the manganese to glass, iron, cobalt to glass, nickel, copper, and so on, we have 4 and 6 as well. Said normally 4 and 6 appears many times. Many complexes adopt those structures. Can be either be hydro, they can be square planet, hollow, they can also be hydro. So those are different complexes. The coordination numbers in the geometry. The most common coordination numbers, as you have said, 4 and 6 and 26. Some of the ions have a constant coordination number. So are you following, please? I would like to know if you are hearing me correctly.
Yes, we are hearing.
Okay, you are seeing that you have said that the most common coordination numbers among in many complexes we find is 4, they are 4 and 6. So some metal ions have a constant coordination number. An example is chromium 3 plus and cobalt 3 plus. Their coordination, whenever you get cobalt 3 plus, you know that this complex is octahedral, which means it has 60 ligands. So this is the constant. So whenever you get it, be sure that it is chromium 3 plus or cobalt 3 plus, it is the coordination number with 6. The coordination number 6 means there are 6 ligands around this central metal. So the size of the ligand affects the coordination number. So if the ligand is pretty big, as you understand, it will not be easier for the central atom to accommodate many ligands around itself. So which means the size also is quite important for in a central metal to accommodate many or less ligands. An example is this one. For example, when you have the ligand fluorine, as you know, the fluorine is the smallest atom on the periodic table, isn't it? You remember? Because the size will decrease when you go from left to right, which means the smallest atom is fluorine. So, but when you go down, you will see that the size is increasing and the chloride is more, is bigger than the fluorine, which means when you are going to form a complex with iron and fluorine, because the fluorine is quite small, allowing the iron you can accommodate 6 ligands of fluorine. Why? Because the chloride is quite big, you can't accommodate many. It's possible only to accommodate 4 around the iron. Is it clear for you? Which means the size is quite important, because they are surrounding this central metal, and each atom needs to make the bond between the central metal and the ligand. It shows that as the size is increasing, the number of ligands will be reducing around the central atom. So, the amount of the charge transferred from the ligand to metal affects coordination number. So, for example, the nickel, this ligand of nickel and ammonia, where we have 6 ligands also, is stable, but on this one, the nickel cyanide is stable. Let's see. The amount of the charge transferred from ligand to metal affects the coordination number. So, which means our coordination, the coordination number should be having in the complex 54, 6. It also depends. Sorry. Sorry. Charge which is transferred from the ligand to the central atom. So here, as we have. Complex C. complexes are either the tetrahedral square planar, commonly seen for DH meter ions. When once we have central metal, which is a DA, DH and then when you make the electronic configuration and you find that you have D8, you know that you may be having either tetrahedron or square planar. So the six coordinates are the coordinates of the tetrahedron. I think this was already seen. So for the ligands, just to explain what is a ligand, I will not take too much time because I have already talked about it. Can it be either an atom, can it be an ion, can it be a molecule. So the formation of a metal ligand bond, therefore, can be described as the interaction between a Lewis base and a Lewis acid. So a Lewis base here is known as the ligand. It is a donor of electrons. Finally, the Lewis acid is an acceptor. So the resulting bond is often called the coordinate covalent bond. A ligand that can form one bond to a metal ion is called a monodentate ligand. Let's see, for example, when you take ammonia, you see that it contains only one lone pair electron, which is, comes from the nitrogen. So this lone pair will form just a coordinate covalent bond to the central metal. So because the ammonia contains only this one possible lone pair to form the bond to the central atom, it will be called a monodentate. Monodentate because it is a symbol. So back when once you have it's called the monodentate or unidentate and so on. Just to say that it is one tooth, one possible bond or one possible coordinate covalent bond to be formed. But we see that example of unidentity ligands are shown in the table. We see them right here. Some ligands have more than one atom, which will be a lone electron pair that can be formed to emit. Such ligands are said keratin ligands or kerats. So let's see them. For example, here, as you see, we have this molecule, which is the ethyl diamine. So in the ethyl diamine, as you know, we have two headings, which are formed by NH2. Do you understand? Are you seeing? You see my screen, please?
Yes,
I hope yes. Okay. So as
you see,
in this molecule, you have two heads or two tails, but all of them they contain the nitrogen and H2. So those two, it shows that for one head, you have a possibility to form a coordinate covalent bond to the head. So which means you have two covalent coordination bonds in this molecule. So if you can form a cycle like this one, this is what you call a keratin ligand, because it can form what you call the keratin. So it shows that the keratin means normally the cloth. So this is a bidentate ligand because it forms there's two dents. So bident means there's two dents. But also it forms the keratin. A ligand that can form two bonds to a metal ion is called a ligand. So a keratin can exist only when you can form two or more bonds with the central atom. So let's go on to look at how can we have different ligands. It is not difficult, but it takes to require more atoms on the So the nomenclature of organic chemistry has changed. All that researchers multiple amounts of data. Contemporary use for naming coordination of compounds. Chapter where we see how we can name different ligands. The different, of course, the ligands and the different different complex atoms, molecules, like different complexes, and the different ligands, how they are named, even from the contemporary nomenclature. Ligands are frequently named using older trivial names rather than the entire recorded for CO equality carbon, and but we'll find it in many times once we are going to name them. We sometimes it's different when you go, for example, to the POSFI for the common name, but for the IUPAC, it is this phosphate. There's many others which are somehow different, but they are not named. For example, you can have amido wine in the IUPAC, it is called as amido. So, but let's go on to see really how we can give those ingredients. Let's see the keratin amines. The keratin amines, to have carrots, as I have said, you need to have at least more than one. You should have the least possible is to have two atoms which can form the coordination covalent bond to the central, so which means the smallest possible is this one with in amines is this one, ethan yama or ethylene yama. So here we have the tridentate where you can use this compound. As you see, we have three nitrogen atoms in this structure, which shows that we can have three bonds to the same tetra, and so on. For example, in detail. So let's go to the nomenclatures. The cation comes first, followed by the anion. When you have the simple molecule, this one, you see here, you have the amines. Leave out one, try. What does it mean? Once we are going to name the coordination compounds, so you first of all see the central metal, and you find its oxidation state. This is one, or if it is two. So remember that oxidation state is the same as the primary valence, but it's very different from the secondary valence. Clear? Who can tell us? I'm going to see someone who can tell us the difference between the primary valence and the primary valence and the secondary valence. Who can give us this difference? I will call someone whose name is from to see just if you are also following. So, Forte, can you tell us?
Yes. Hello?
Can I proceed? Hello? We have seen that primary, we have seen that secondary variance, it is the one an atom can use to react with the Lewis acid. So they are the number which they are the variants that can be used by an atom to form a complex. And the primary, it is different because primary variants, it will be used by an atom to react with a charge of the negative side. If it is positive, it will be used to react with another ions of an atom which has negative. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Prote. Have you understood, all of you? Is it correct or not? What is he saying? So, just for your clarification, remember that what you call have called the bond acid base is this one, which is called the covalent coordination bond. Covalent coordination bond or coil. So it is commonly known as this formation of complex between the central metal and the atom. It is quite special because there is a ligand which donates its electron to the central atom. Normally, as you know, to form the bond, there is either a sharing or a transfer. But here, it's not really the same. Here, it shows that there is the two electrons which comes from the ligands. Is it clear? To fill the atomic orbital of the central metal. So, which means for the primary advance, the ability to give fixed electrons to form, how many electrons will be lost by sodium. It's 101, we call it, this is the primary balance of sodium. It's 101. When you go through the atoms, like for example, cobalt, it can lose 3, it becomes a 3 plus, it can lose 2, so we can say that it has 2 primary balance. It can be plus 2 or plus 3, it's okay? It can lose 2 or 3. So which means the balance can be 2 or 3. So then for the secondary balance, if I can, it is this ability of how many ligands will be accommodated by the central atom. So referring to the orbitals in the central atom, the empty orbitals, it has how many lone pairs from the ligands will be accepted by this central atom. This number of the ligands which can be accepted by this central atom will be called its secondary valence. If it is, it can accept only 4, what we call the secondary valence will be 4. If it is 6, the secondary valence will be 6, and so on. So let's go on. So when you need, for the first loop, when you need to name your complex, we start first of all by the name of your cation. Cation, I mean the central atom. For example, here we have, when you go to the A, it is silica. Then it is formed by the anion. Let's see here now. The cation comes first, followed by the anion. Let's go to the 2B, for example. We have potassium, iron, and cyanide. But here, I would like to give you the hint. Those ones who are not in the coordination sphere will be so close. We have the, no matter the complex we have, the complex we have here is exocyanophthalate. Are you together? Why do we call it exocyanophthalate? Where does it come from? Phthalate. We'll get more explanations later. But normally, when the coordination number, the coordination sphere, I mean this in black, in this black, we have the iron and the 6 ligands. When the total charge becomes negative, I mean here you will find that Fe cyanide 6, the charge is negative 3. Because we need also 3 potassium to balance, or 3 potassium as counter ions. Are you together? So when it is negative, you take the acronym of the metal and you add word act, which means it shows that it is negatively charged, and so on. We'll see. So for the first one, you see that we have silver, followed by the chloride, and so on. When you go to the second law, the inner coordination sphere.
Excuse me.
Yes.
Okay. Can you zoom a little bit? Because you are not seeing the screen.
Yes. Okay. Now it's okay.
Yes.
Okay.
That is okay.
Okay, let's go on. So let's see the second thing. The inner coordination sphere is enclosed in square brackets. So what does it mean? It's an example there. So what we call the inner coordination sphere is where we have the complex size. Complex size in the bracket. So let's see. Although the metal is provided first within the brackets, the ligand within the coordination sphere are lightened before the metal in the formula name. Let's repeat again. Although the metal, respecting the first rule, of course, is provided first. For example, when it's copper, we write copper. Okay. Then, first within the brackets, the ligands within the coordination sphere are lightened before the metal in the formula name. So we have used even before, but the rule comes here. So let's see, for example, you see here the coordination sphere we have the copper, or we have copper and the ammonia. Are you together? Or amine, because we call them amine in the nomenclature we have seen. Well, if you remember, I can go back and you see when you have NH3, what is NH3? We call it encounter irony, of course, they suffer. So here, I will start by, of course, proper, but remember that the ligands in the coordination sphere will come first. That's why we say determine proper, and then followed by the suffer. Because it says that those ligands in the coordination sphere will come first. The same on the following one. You have cobalt and this 6 amine. So we say it's amine, cobalt, then I think there is no problem here. But let's see the number of ligands of each kind is indicated by prefix. Yeah, even though you have seen the rule, it was used, but the rule comes here. When you have 2, it will be called E, 3, tetra, and so on. But in simple cases, the prefix in the second law are used if the ligands names already includes those prefixes or is complicated. What does it mean? For example, in a complex, if I have already used D, and I have also to use D again, you can't say DD, but you can say B, because you have B somewhere or D somewhere and so on. Let's see examples here. We have here, for example, D. Chloro, this is then diamine, cobalt, and so on. So that's the form of the one. Which means I could say D, chloro D. No, because already I have the D. You have to change and you use this. Normally it is the same, it means 2. All of them it means 2, but you can't follow DD. But you can say D, chloro, this, and so on. Or this, D, pyramid, and so on. Depending to the coordination sphere, of course, because once you are going to name, you have to start by the coordination sphere which you have in your book. So let's see why. For example, in this one, in the first one, you started by D whenever it is needed, because you have other how to say D, and yeah. But let's see, come here. As you have said, you have to see the you have 3. Bipyridine. So no matter the molecule which you have, it's bipyridine there, and the current one is iron to soil, and so on. So remember that you can't follow this or 3-3, but you can use this and three when it's necessary. Of course, when you have you have questions?
Yeah. Any question? Yeah, there is a question.
Yes. Can you ask it?
On B. Why we can't say that three pyramid? Why you
so,
say
yeah, we don't honor the speed. Okay, listen, I understand your question. Because the first way of naming is not honored to have three speed. No, but when once you have already been building in the molecule, it means that you have already used the first rhyme of nomenclature. So, which means the following one, you will need to use the three. So when you use 3D, also it is not allowed. It's better use 3 and D. Is it clear? Because
yes, I understand.
In bipyridine, you have already used the first line in the nomenclature. But it's better once you go to the third one, you use 3D. Okay. So let's go to the first law. Ligands are generally written in the alphabetic order. Once you're going to write the ligands, you have to follow the alphabetic order. For example, you have in the coordination sphere, you see that you have ammonia and chloride in the first, in the example. So you have amine and you have chloride. Oh, okay. So what is the order? this year, the Ramayana and the Prologue of Baruch. So when you go to the Ramayana, is it the Ramayana is it because of the in alphabetic order, A starts or A is the comes before C. So let's see to the B. You have these compounds where you have amine also, and you have bromine, and you have chlorine, and you have I think you have the four ones. You have methylamine, and you have bromine and the chlorine. So let's start. So as you see, which one will come first is amine because this is A, and the following one will be bromo because this is B, and the third one will be chloro because this is C, and the ethyl as it starts by E. That's why you said amine, bromo, chloro, ethyl, amine, platinum. And the formula is that one. They are quite long names like those ones. So let's see the fifth rule. Anionic ligands are given in no suffix. So nitro ligands retain their usual name. So when it is a nitro ligand, if it's usually coordinated water is called aqua, and coordinated ammonia is called amine. That's what you have seen in the previous table already. Two systems exist for designing charge or oxidation number. The Stokes system. So, to design the oxidation number of the central atom, you can use the two systems. The first one is what we call the Stokes system, and the second one is the Ewing-Barnett system. So, what are those system means for you, or how can it be used in nomenclature or using the oxidation numbers to different complexes which we'll be having? So, in the Stokes system, puts the calculated oxidation number of the metal as a Lohmann numero in parentheses after the metal name. It's like one you have already used. So will be used Lohmann, you know, where rather than presenting the one or plus one, we use the letter I in capital letters. Okay? So although this is the most commonly employed method, use the metal, it's no bad that the oxidation date of a metal within a complex can be ambiguous and difficult to specify. So as you see, you just give if it is a one, you need to specify if it is plus one or plus two and so on. So this is what you call the Stokes system. Stokes system by using these Lohmann letters. Let's go to the second one, the Ewing-Barnett system. Put the charge on the coordinates layer in the parentheses after the name of the metal. This convention often offers an ambiguous identification of the species. So for this one, it is plus two, it is shown. So here is the examples. For example, you can write the tetramine platinum 2 or tetramine platinum 2 plus. All of them are the same, but by using different system of giving steps to the methods, they are the same. But as you see, as you have said, one can be somehow confusing. In either case, if the charge is negative, the suffix it is added to the name. Let's see, for example, for those this B, tetrachloroplatinate, which means tetrachloroplatinate. Which means we know that the coordination sphere of our complex is charged negatively, platinum and the four chlorine, which gives this charge as the platinum has two plus, and the chlorine four negative. As you understand, we have the coordination sphere which is negative charge. That's why the molecule or the name will be given by in a suffix identity to show that it's negative. And so on. For you, I think you are ready to understand this system for giving the. So for certain, if there is plus two, We are lucky because the condition of prayer is the same as the charge of the metal. Clear?
So it means that
for the previous stock, him he keeps honor the coordination in the gives the coordination state of central method. Therefore, don't have any problem for the A because the coordination state, the charge of the coordination state is the same as the charge of the central method. When we go to the second. Plus, here I'm also the charge is plus two, and the coordination here is negative two. So, here also there is more ambiguity, all of them is two, even though it's one on one side of the glass, and on the other side is zero. But when you go to this one, where the platinum is four, I mean, the primary balance is four, why the coordination is there is there? The ambiguity. But as you have said, the early basket system is quite a good one, the excellent one. Besides the history, because the coordination, you can't really have any problem knowing the charge or positive. Why did follow the basket one? For him, he shows, it only show you the oxidation state of the central metal. It's up to you to know if the ligand is negative charge, so that you know either you react it, because you know that the ligand is negatively charged. But for this, because you use charge of the pair, a lot of the same.
Yes, that's clear.
Very good. Okay, let's go on. Okay, here also I think we have already started to see it. The prefix design in there. But referring to the geometric of the molecule. For example, if I have this or advanced germany platinum, so I mean that I can have two possibilities of having those two molecules. But if I need to precise that you will be working with trans, I will only write trans germany the chlorocobalt two or cobalt three. Okay, depending to what molecule I have given you. Just I can precise if I have trans or if I have a cis. So for 8, this one is quite a good one and a special one. There's what we call the bridging ligands, where you can have a bridge between the two ligands. So bridging ligands between the two metal ions have the prefix mu, which shows you that in your molecule you have two different, it's like you have two different ligands, but which has a union. This union is what we call a bridge. It's like you have two hills, but between those two hills, you have a blade which links them. Okay? So example here is trees determine new dichlorocobalt, which means I have two complexes. One is the tetramine, another one is the dichloro, dehydroxocobalt, but there is a link, I mean, there is a blade between them, which is a cobalt. So we will see the structure they can look like. So we can have amido mu hydrox, so tetramine cobalt. Those are different ways how we can name or different rules. The last one, which is here, the 9. When the complex is negatively charged, the names for those metals are derived from the sources of their symbols. So here it's clear: iron, ferrite, copper, couplet, lead, plumbet, silver, argentate, and so on. When you need to give the, when you find that the coordination state is negative, you will not say ironate. No, here the name comes from the source of the symbols. So it's like this. So examples are given here. We don't example so rather than saying tetraflor, color ironate. So we call it velat as the name comes from bel, which means iron in French. Okay, let's go on. So I'm happy that we have almost finished the first part. The following is the exercise to see really if you remember what you have said to cover in the morning from the first slide. Go there quickly. We have said that we do. many of them are recollected. I will give you some others where you can give the nomenclature of different complexes and so on. So ones I have here, they are recollected. The rules used to collect them are given also. So what we are going to do, I will ask you to go through, to read them. And as I have said to a class representative, I would like to get more concentrated our next session on exercise rather than going back to those theories. So I think it's good because here from the theories to explain online, it can work. But once we need to do exercises, to discuss together about exercises, it's better we'll be working face to face. And I believe that next week, this coming week, of course, I learned that Monday will be there will be a holiday, but you can see at what time we can meet next week for exercises, so that we can plan also follow the following weeks. So let's go to the isomers for exercise. I will ask you to go to lead through. You have them, the corrected ones, and the other exercises which I will propose you. I will send you a list of exercises to do on this first part which we have already covered. Let's see. For isomers, okay. For isomers, here it is. So it's just quite a few slides we are going to see. Coordination isomers. So we need to understand the term isomers in coordination compounds. It's quite simple, but it is quite really a very good, interesting chapter. It's quite amazing. You can enjoy it, I believe. So, are you tired? You need black? I don't think so, because you have lost too much time by working with the connection. So, okay, let's go fast. So, when two or more species, as you know, when you want to mean an isomers, you should be having two or more species which have same formula, but they can have different properties, either the space presentation, the geometry, and so on. Although isomers contain exactly the same types of and number of atoms, the arrangement of the atoms differ, and this leads to different properties, different types of isomers. This is known as the isomers. We will be considering here two main types of isomers. Which one? So in our case, in the coordination compounds, here we will be considering what we call structural isomers and slow isomers. In the structure, as you understand, it just say about the bond, how normal bonds are structured in the complex, where the isomers contain the same.
Excuse me.
Yes, I understand.
Can you go on? Can you increase the size?
Sorry?
Can you increase the size of the screen?
Oh, okay. Sorry. Thank you. Like this, yes. So, in structural isomerism, so we say it's where the isomers contain the same atoms that one or more bonds differ. And we'll see how it can differ in these complexes. So in stereo isomerism, it's where all the bonds in the isomers are the same, but the spatial arrangements of the atoms will be different. So let's see how it looks. Yeah, it's right in the diagram which shows different types of isomerism. Each of those classes also has subclasses which in structural isomerism you can have what you call the coordination isomerism and the linkage isomerism. In stereo isomerism you can have what you call the geometric, like cis and trans, and the optical isomerism. So let's see the four different types we have presented here. So in linkage, let's start by the linkage isomers. In linkage isomers, I will not take too much time because it's quite simple and clear to everyone. When you see, for example, these images which are at the light, you see, you have the same molecule for A and B. But when you see For example, one of the bonds. One bond we have here is cobalt nitrogen, which is different from cobalt oxygen. So this is what we call the linkage. The way it is linked to the central metal is very different. So the remaining theory, theories can be. Of course, remember that the isomers are different, even properties. So if you are making a medicine which can cure any disease, once you have the structure of food, to have the same atoms is not enough, but the way the atoms are linked to one another makes different those two complexes or those two compounds to be different. Let's see, for example, here, even in physical properties, when you see the molecule you have at the light, where we have nitrogen, which bonds to cobalt, and at the right side where we have oxygen, which bonds to the central atom, as you see, the two compounds are quite different, even in color, even in properties, even in the application. Okay, sorry. Are you following?
This is for
yes. Okay, here for you. So, so you can have different linkage isomers in different complexes, depending to the way one or two different bonds are linked to the central atom. So, the second one, the coordination isomers. They differ in what is inside the coordination sphere. Remember that the coordination sphere are those ones who are in it. For example, when it started here, in the bracket here. So here, as you see, for example, in those two, in A, you have the coordination sphere, which is formed by chloride, amine, and the sulfate. But when you see on in the same line, you have in the coordination sphere, we have chromium, ammonia, so amine, I mean, and the bromine. So which shows that there have been exchange of bromine in the sulfate, where in the first compound, the bromine is in the coordination sphere, while in the second, sulfate has gone out of the coordination sphere. Okay? In the first molecule, sulfate is in coordination sphere and bromine is outside as a counterion. But in the second one, bromine comes in the coordination sphere and the sulfate becomes a counterion. So this is what you call the coordination isomers. So which means the way those two complexes, they show the same atoms, of course, because we have equal numbers of atoms, but the way they are linked, the way they are linked in the coordination sphere are quite different. The way they are linked to the central atom, they are quite different. Even though the molecule shows the similar atoms, this is what we call the coordination isomers, similar ways for B and C. So let's see to the ionization isomers. This is a type of what you can get from those two past the structure. So the ionization, it means it comes from what you have seen from the coordination isomers. Because when you see, for example, in the past, you have a question? So let's see the group we have here, A, chromium, amine, and sulfate, and the chlorine, which is the counterion. In the second also, the sulfate becomes the counterion. Once you are going to react this molecule with it, we form the precipitate of silver nitrate when silver nitrate is added to the complex or to the solution. What does it mean? It shows you that, of course, because the countdown does not belong to the coordination sphere, which means its bond is quite not really, it can be ionized quite easily. So here, as you see, when we react with the isomerism, it is chromium sulfate. Okay, I understand.
Excuse me.
Yes. Are you gone? Okay.
I'm saying that.
I'm going to explain.
What the message?
Okay. I would like to go back and the file. Even I can explain here, there's no problem. But for those ones who do not understand what is a coordination strategy, I don't know if it knows also the what we have called the count ions. Let's consider this first molecule. The molecule has chlorine, amine, and bromine. So those three atoms, those three groups are they form what you form the chemistry. That's why they are shifted in it, those brackets, which shows that they are separate from bromine. So the bromine here is called the count ion. So the remaining is probably the coordination sphere. So the same for the following one, where we have amine and the bromine, those ones which are in the bracket, they show what we call a coordination sphere for this compound. In the sulfate here, it is called a counter ion. So the coordination sphere will be those ones which represents, which makes the direct bonds between the ligands and the central atom. The molecules or atoms or those ligands which makes a direct bond, the covalent bond between the central atom and the ligands are called or belongs to what you call the coordination sphere. While the spectator, what I can call the spectator ion, which is there just to balance the charge to make the molecule neutral, is called the count ion. The count ion, if it is one, or count ion, if they are many. Have you understood before I continue? Anyone else who can tell us if he's understanding? I need to hear from you.
We are understanding very well.
Okay, very good. Let's go on now. If she has the same problem, still has the same problem, you can please explain to her, okay? You can help her.
Question?
Yes,
please.
Yes.
On C, I didn't understand the isotope.
Okay, let's see it on C. What is the difference on C? So you see normally in this compound, in this complex C, we have it's like you have two complexes which are together, okay? It's a complex where you have like two complexes together. Where you have platinum and four ammonia and the platinum with four chloride. So you see there, in the next one, it's like you have mixing, okay? Like you have mixed, then you have platinum, chlorine, and the three ammonia, and the platinum, chlorine, and the three ammonia. Are we together? Which shows that the coordination players we have in C, in the first molecule of C, are quite different of the coordination spheres we have in the second molecule of C. It's clear for you?
Clear.
Okay, very good. Let's go. Okay. So we are here on the ionization isotope. I have said it's not really special. You have on the diagram because it's a type of coordination isomerism. Here it shows you how quite different molecules, how those molecules are different. When you see, for example, in A, you have amine chromium and sulfate, and the counter in the chloride. So when you make this molecule to react with silver nitrate, the precipitate which will be formed will be silver nitrate. Or in the second, barium sulfate, because normally chlorine and sulfate are count ions in different food molecules. The same to the foreign molecules, which shows us that even with the placement of water, so having the molecule, you can have none, mono, or dihydrate. So depending to the number of water molecule you have, you say that this is a hydrate or solvate isomer. Not just they differ from the number of. For example, you can have dehydrate, antihydrate, and so on. Those are normally almost the, they are like the isomers, but they differ to the number or to the position of the water molecules in the structure. So stereoisomers, so which means you have already covered the first type of isomers, which we have called, which was called the structural isomers. Now we can go to the stereoisomers. Is it clear? Or the first one, you don't have any problem?
No problem.
Okay, very good. So the stereoisomers, as you understand, we have said that the stereoisomers we have same of course formula, same attachment of atoms, but atoms are different volumes of space. They have same bonds but different spatial isomers. What does it mean? You can have in the isomers, I think you have done it, you have studied in the first in the stereochemistry. So the chemistry you are doing with the Curtis and Dr. Where you are seeing the you are studying chemistry. I don't remember exactly the title of the course, but you have seen what you call, when you say the spatial arrangement, you find some atoms are in play or behind or and so on. Okay, so this spatial arrangement makes the molecule to be different, and it can characterize this type of isomers. Let's see the two types we can have here. You can have what we call the geometrical isomers. Normally we see them for cis and trans, and we see what you call the optical isomers, how they rotate the plane. So the geometrical, I don't want to talk too much to the cis and trans, because I think you are familiar from secondary school up to now. You have already know what is cis and you know what is trans. Let's see, just for passing. Having a compound like this one, an isomer, a complex like this one, you can have a structure where you have, you see the A and B, which one is the trans, which one is the cis?
A is cis, while B is trans.
Very good. When you know that one is a direct neighbor, you know that cis. When you know that it is at the farthest, the similar atoms are at the farthest distance, at the possible farthest distance, you know that this is what you call a trans. Okay, that's good. This is a type of isomer, the isomer we have, and you have a cis and trans. So the molecules may be the same, the atoms are the same, and the ways the bonds are linked are the same, the same parameters. But when you see those two molecules, they are quite different. Even in the application, they are quite different. Here there is examples of cis and trans. So this is quite very interesting. Example here, the geometrical isomerism also occurs in octahedral complex. Those are examples which you can observe yourself to see how they look. And they are quite really good shapes in nature. So let's go to the optical. So the previous one was the geometrical. Now we are going to the almost the last one, which is the optical isomers. Is there any question to the geometrical?
Yes,
it's clear.
Okay, very good. Clear. Okay, thank you. But I would like to know from your side, how students have worked. I don't really have that. On my screen, I see that you are not many, but last time you have told me that maybe you can be two or three persons or 20 in the same by using the same device. Is it the case or?
No, sir, I think there are some students who are using one device, whereas there are too many, so you can proceed.
Okay. Okay, thank you. So I will see, I will see impossible mirror images. So their images cannot be superimposable. So you can have what you call the Kira molecules, which lack an improper axis of rotation, the center of symmetry, or a mirror plane. So which are these shown here? Let's see, for example, we have the molecule here, but once you make a rotation of the molecule will be not superimposable to its image. So those are known as the optical isomers. They can't rotate light in similar ways, we'll see. So commonly for octahedral complexes with pre-bidentate ligands. You see, for example, here, you have the property with the three different atoms, the three different ligands. Of course, they are bidentate ligands which you have here. So those ones we really see how they can rotate the right, and we see that once you make a rotation, they are you can't not superimpose. Let's see an example here. We need to see if they are optical active or not optical active. When we say that is optical active, or when it is not active.
Huh? Excuse me, sir.
Yes, yes, yes.
Can I ask on the on that slide? I'd like to know what does C1, CN, BN, also TO, TO and the I stand for?
Okay, okay. As you have said, there's what you call the rotation axis. It's okay. So there is what you call, for example, the C1, CN, DN are types of axis of rotations. So, but for your need, I think you don't need all those things. But normally, remember that when you say you can have axis of symmetry, you can have those axes we are studying what you call the group theory. So this molecule can be in which type of which group? For you, will not study this course because to be from undergraduate, but will be you may see it at advanced level. So it is a group theory where the molecules are classified in a given group depending to the axis of symmetry. You know, this is a which axis of rotation. It is a C1, it is a C2, it is a C3, and so on. Those are different group of molecules you can have. Okay.
But question. Question.
Yes.
What is the meaning of improper axis of rotation?
Improper axis of rotation. Yes. Let's see. For example, you see, for this molecule which is at the right side, at the left side, you see?
Yes, I see.
Okay. Now, I need to rotate it, okay?
Yes.
So, there is a way of doing these rotations, okay? As you see, for example, here, they are showing the way the rotation was done. It's like by rotating just by 180 degrees, okay, the molecule. Are you together? Are you following?
Yes, I'm following.
Okay, the molecule looks like what you have there down there. So what you have, you can ask me, is it possible to superimpose? So this, there is an axis of rotation which has been done. There is an axis which you have to rotate your molecule up to 180 degrees, for example. Okay? This axis
yes.
which is called the improper axis of rotation. So, and here, for example, for this molecule, you see that the molecule you have here down, cannot be superimposed to this one, because when you see the bone, I don't know if it's clear on your screen, but when you see the bone of the bottom atom And the other atom, which is bound to it in a, I can say in a spherical bond, you see? This gray, is it gray? Gray bond, it is from there. It's like, it's like, isomerism, they are quite similar, but once you rotate them, they cannot be superimposed, which means it is not the same molecule. They form two different molecules. Clear? Just by doing the rotation,
yes, clear, clear.
Form a new molecule. So that's what we call the axis of rotation.
Thank you, thank you.
So by normally, that's what I was saying. There was a close normally for previous promotions, like I remember when you were doing the undergraduate for us, there was this course which was called group theory in chemistry. Group theory was one of the important courses where we could see those different group of atoms, where you have the molecules can be classified in one group, in C1, in G1, so on. It's okay. But for you, this one was the most just for very people capture the basic knowledge at undergraduate and when it may be. So, if there's no any other question, let's go to the following slide. So we can take also this molecule to see how they look. You see also the two molecules which you have here, by doing the rotation, you see that when you take the molecule at the left and the molecule at the right, you find that by using what you call the mirror image, you have the first one is not optically active, but the second one is optically active. So you see rotating the light in different ways. Is it clear for you?
Clear, clear.
Okay. It is clear.
Okay, the isomers have opposite effects on plane polarized light. When light is emitted from a source such as glowing filament, the oscillating electric field of the photons in the beam are oriented random. If this light is passed through a polarizer, only the photons with electric field oscillating in a single domain constituting a plane polarized light. Here, that's what you can see on the following figure, like this one. So you have the light which comes in all planes, in all directions. But putting what you call the polarized plane, or polarizing filter, it shows that it selects different types of lights which are going in one direction. This is what we call the polarized light. So from a source, they come in various orientations, but by using this polarizing plane or polarizing filter, it selects only those ones which are in the same direction. And we say that we have what we call polarized light. So let's go back slightly to help you to see what you have dumped. We are here. So for optical isomers properties, optical isomers, they are not non-superimposable. You have images, killer molecules, non-superimposable on its mirror images, and enantiomers, a pair of non-superimposable mirror images, that's all how they are called. So this is not a minus, but it's a sign which gives you what it is. Polarimeter is an instrument that measures the rotation of polarized light by an optically active compound, and so on. Dextrorotatory rotation of polarized light clockwise, when it is rotating clockwise, we call it dextrorotatory. When it is a level rotatory, we say that it is rotating in counterclockwise or anticlockwise. Lessemates, it is a mixture of 50-50 mixtures of enantiomers. No rotation of polarized light as it is nor extra or level rotation. Okay? It is a mixture, it's 50-50, of course. It is balanced. So a human found a non-superimposable mirror image. You can take your hand, to go on mirror and try to superimpose the image and your Leo hand. You will see that it's not possible. It's quite a very good example of non-superimposable images. Okay? Isomers of each other. You understand when you take the trans molecules in their images, they are really the same molecules. They are not isomers. Okay? But when you go, for example, to the cis isomers, let's see about the cis. What happens? Isomer two cannot be superimposable exactly on isomer one. Let's see we have the molecule there, but let's see it's the isomer one and the isomer two. So the isomer one, as you see, we have a direct neighbors there, yes, and you have this one. So as you see, those two molecules, you can't superimpose them because the bonds are quite different. When you see here, they are quite the direct neighbors, but in another one they are quite at the highest distance. So that from we know that one cannot be superimposed. Polarized light, you have seen. So how the polarized light rotating the plane? So rotating the plane of polarized light, polarization of light. You have here, as you have said, from the source, they come to the polarizing field meter. Then there is a tube containing the sample, and you can see the electro-rotator or lever-rotator. What does it mean? Can you please follow me? Here you have a polarized light. So I have said that you have a light which has taken a given direction. And here, you have selected in the source. You have the tube which contains the sample. And you have our compound there. You need to know if the compound which is there is the dextrorotator or the revolutator, okay? So when this the light which is passing through this sample, we'll see that maybe it is rotating to clockwise or anti-clockwise. We know that this compound is dextro or levorotator. Do you understand how can we know this molecule? Okay, which is
good. No, we are not understanding clearly.
So as I have said, we would like to know if we would like to take our molecules and see if it is the extrorotatory or revolutatory. To know if it can rotate the light clockwise or anti-clockwise. Okay, so we have an instrument here, what we call the tube. Which contains our sample, where we put our complex, and we pass the polarized light. You understand? Passing the polarized light, our sample, we will see that either the molecule will be able to rotate the light in clockwise or in anticlockwise. When it is in clockwise, we call it extra, or when it is in counterclockwise, we call it revolutatory. It will go at right or at left, okay? That's how we can identify if the molecule is the pro or the volatile, okay? It's quite simple.
Yeah.
I think we have the polarimeter in the physics lab. So we can see, for those ones who are doing the physics, they can ask maybe Dr. Fenias. I don't know who is teaching optics. Maybe Dr. Fenias? Who is he? But
he is Mugeman
alone. Okay, very good. He's a very good friend of mine. I can see if you can also learn this science for those who are doing biology. For those who are doing biology, to see if they can really identify the extrorotator and the volatator. But it's quite simple. Here also, we have almost finished also the isomerisms. So those are the exercises. I don't know if you still have enough energy to continue. I can open a new chapter, then we can follow.
Continue, please.
Are you confused?
Yes.
So, but remember that you have many exercises. I would like to give you this time to go pass through those exercises and resume on Monday if possible. It's okay? Because Monday, let's meet on Monday, and Monday we continue with the two remaining chapters. We have the bond theories in coordination compounds, and we'll be seeing the last one, the crystal field theory, and our course will be almost over. It will remain only for practicals and the exercises in the class. Okay? So we are trying to check on.
Can I ask?
You have questions?
Yeah. Even though there are some exercises which are collected.
Here you have many exercises which are collected in those slides. You will go to read and understand the way they are collected, but I will share with you some others and the collected exercises for the future. Okay?
Yes, I am having a problem on the collected exercises. If you allow me to back on the slides, on the part of the first chapter covers, there is a problem on the naming which is somehow confusing, and if you allow me, you can add more clarification about it so that it will be on the same line.
Okay, which one? I don't know. Can you tell me the number of the slide?
The question of about the name of the complexes.
Nomenclature. Okay, the first part of the module. Yes. Okay. Let's go there. Let's go back. I think it's this one. Nation compounds. Okay, so. And I'm happy that the network have been friendly this time. It's not really like at the beginning. Let me close this one. And be patient when I open it. So, as I've seen, we need to be patient at the beginning. It was not possible to join all of us. By this time, the network has been friendly. The last slide, maybe from this one.
Yes.
You tell me where I can stop.
Yeah. There. Yes. The previous one. Yes.
Okay. And this one.
Proceed on next slide.
Next, yes.
Proceed next. Again, next.
Next again.
Next. Next, yes. Next. Next.
Yes. Next, yes.
Yes, next.
No, there's no next. Mean those ones, those exercises are there.
Yes, the previous one, they're not there. But example two.
It says one, example two.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Here we have.
Yeah, the question is the C, the name of the C. The way it had been answered is not clear.
Okay, let's go there to the C.
Yes.
So we have a molecule like this one which you have here. Okay, then you need to name it. Okay?
Yes.
So how do you give this? First, we first determine the oxidation state of the ion by looking at the other charged species. Okay? Are you together?
Yeah.
Okay, by looking in your, by taking your molecule, you will find that the iron which is there, let's go together, let's go back together. We have nitro which has one negative charge, okay?
Yes.
And you have two nitro here, okay? Which means two negative. And you have sulfate.
Yeah.
One single sulfate. With two negative charges. Let's see. I see also some confusion also. Okay. Wait. Then the molecule will be designed as it, like this one. We first determine the oxidation state of the ion by looking at the other charges. The ethylamine is neutral, yes, that's correct. That's the two ions must carry a total positive charge of 6. Let's see. Okay, very good, yes, it is good, yes, I see. Okay. So, does the two ions must carry the total positive 6 and the negative charges? Yes, this means that each ion has the oxidation state and it is designated as iron C plus. So, the problem is where is the problem here on C plus?
No, the question is on the name. The way they use it to name it is different to the way they describe it.
Okay, since the name, okay, for this case, we have determined the primary valence of iron, there's no problem. Since the name already contains D, we use B instead of D to indicate the two EN ligands, ethylene diamine ligands. Put together, is there any problem for this one?
Yes, sir. You're saying you're talking to a train diamond ligands, but you're having four.
We have four in the.
Yeah.
Go back to see. Okay. No. A train diamond are not four. They are two.
No. How?
EN, you see? EN
is two, and was the two.
No, EN means ethylene diamine. So we have this ethylene diamine.
Yes. What I'm saying,
yes.
Once you're seeing on the same screen, you can see nitro. They are saying there are four because you have a nitro in the parentheses, which is multiplied by two. But also, there is two, another two behind the bracket, which is also multiplying the two that nitro, which is making it be four for that case of nitro.
Okay, I see your concern now.
Yeah.
Okay, I understand. Normally we should be having now four ethylene diamine, okay?
Yeah.
Because you have the double of
Yes.
Okay, let's see. Let's see together again. Yes. Since the name at the band already exists, B, we use this phrase. Okay, multiply the trees.
Yeah, sure. Because you're having four ethereum diamine and the four neutral.
Okay. Right. So I will check and I will correct. Maybe we may discuss on it next time. Okay, you are right. I see also there is some challenges. Okay,
yes,
yeah, I will check and maybe if I found the supporting challenges. Okay, but you are right on what you are asking. Okay? Okay, let's meet for next time. And thank you for those ones who have been able to attend. Those ones who are have not been able to attend, please help them to understand what you have learned today. And let's try to be patient also next time to see if the network can be friend for us and we can do better together. Okay.
Yes.
So I wish you. I wish you a good weekend and enjoy the exercise which I will send it to you. Try to revise those ones which are here, and the next time also I will be together if you can collect many in your class so that you can use the first phase for exercise, not ready to go in the theories during first to face lessons. So let's go here, our class, and meet for on Monday. I will put our class representative, please. Okay?